Welcome to VultureFest. I thought we were walking out together, so that's why I'm a little thrown off right now. but I'm Alex Jung. I'm an editor at Vulture, the best pop culture site in the world. we already have like an awesome lineup of events that are happening, some of which are happening at this very moment, but the one that I'm sort of most thrilled and honored and slightly terrified to be hosting is the one with Tig Notaro. No doubt you already know who she is and don't need an introduction, but just in case you got a random ticket somehow and have no idea who she is, she's a stand-up comic whose work is best known on Conan, This American Life.
This is why I didn't walk on yet. Hold on.
I think, right. We rehearsed this. And her podcast, Professor Blastoff. She recently filmed a Showtime special called Knock Knock, It's Tig Notaro, where she went around to places around Middle America and did sets at people's houses. And she's currently writing a memoir, and she's on tour right now. And her first HBO comedy special, Tig Notaro, Boyish Girl Interrupted, is set to air on HBO on Saturday, August 22nd. It's not TV, it's HBO. Please welcome Grammy nominee Tig Notaro. What was it like watching Clown Service with an audience?
Well, I've done that before.
Okay. Did this audience feel different?
Yes, it felt like a group of individuals. I like what stand-up I do so regularly that I'm not interested in watching or hearing myself do stand-up, but acting is such a bizarre thing that I kind of just ended up in, and so I'm kind of intrigued watching my, I'm just like, that's so, huh? But yeah, I'm fine with it.
Do you have notes for yourself?
No, not a one. I feel removed enough from watching something like this where I'm just like, good job, Tig. and it was just, it's something that I wrote years ago and that I've wanted to make for so long. And so there's also that really good feeling of accomplishment and just, I don't know, I'm not hard to please, I guess.
What were you thinking when you were making it or writing it at first?
Well, it really is based on a real time in my life. And I really did call a clown service. So it was fun. The clown dispatch refused in real life to send one of their clowns over to my house. And what happened was, to answer your question, I was so excited to kind of have it unfold with them allowing me to have a clown and kind of to explore that awkwardness, the one-on-one of the horror,
right,
the clown would have felt walking into. I mean, at the time I smoked and it was just like a cloud of smoke in the apartment. And but I was staying with a friend of mine who was going to college at the time, and I was just really bummed. And I said, honestly, I feel like the only thing that would make me happy is if a clown came over here. And she was like, oh my gosh, if you can get a clown to come over here, I will pay for it. I was like, no problem. And calling that clown service and just not ever letting up with the depression and I wish you could hear the actual conversation. She was trying to encourage so many different kinds of parties and ways I could invite friends over, and I was like, yeah, that all sounds horrible.
Did the conversation cheer you up?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, and so yeah, writing it felt really fun to watch it unfold how it possibly might have.
Right. So the woman who plays the clown service phone operator
dispatch
is Stephanie Allen, your partner.
Yep.
And she's right. Also here.
Yeah. Hi, Stephanie.
Was that weird?
Let's see, the applause that she got during my moments. Yeah, frankly, it was. Sorry. It was so fun. I mean, Stephanie is really one of the, if not the funniest person I know, and on a daily basis, just gut laughter comes from me. And to be on set with her, and me directing something the first time, she was kind of my eyes and ears when I was in front of the camera, and she had so many great notes, so insightful about the different characters and the nuances and little tags that she put in there, and I was just in awe. It wasn't weird. We both left there thinking, we should be doing this every second of our lives, creating things and working together, because it really was so, it was so easy.
And are there more projects that you'd want to work on together?
Not one. No, we haven't. There's plenty. We'd love to do all projects together, I think. But we just haven't put one together yet. I have been on the road for, I can't even remember when my tour started.
Well,
but it ends tomorrow. So for good, I'm getting out of comedy. So.
Watching the film, I couldn't help but sort of think about the clown as, you know, as the stand-in for the comic in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. And there's a certain kind of, I don't know, tragedy to the idea of having to make people laugh for a living. Is that...
Thank
that's
you.
Sort of what I that's sort of what I felt. I don't know if a poor read or not.
I mean, no, of course, there's definitely... There's that element to it, and there are moments where you're just not feeling funny, or you have to show up and do a show. I remember not one of my best friends, but a guy that was a friend of mine, and we had the same manager. He died, and I found out right between my early and late show, and I went on stage and just had to do the show and just kind of move that out of my head. And you're going about your life and grocery shopping or something, and you're in a weird headspace, and then somebody's like, hey, I like what you do. And you're like, oh, thanks. Nah. And you're just like, well, I'm just gonna buy this lemon. I'm sorry I've let you down. So yeah, it's odd, you know. And I don't know if anybody heard, but I was diagnosed with cancer a couple years ago. And you know, it was kind of the same thing of I had a show to do and I was in a weird place, and yeah, there's those expectations, right. Or like going to a party, or going to Thanksgiving on my stepfather's side of the family. Mm. It's insane. It's like me at a table with everyone staring at me, and like, have you ever met Jay Leno? You know, just like all these questions about, you know, and like, tell us a joke. And I bought this lemon. But, you know, there's that side of it sometimes, but I also, I really love what I do, and I feel very thankful to have that outlet. Mm.
Is moving into writing, directing, acting more of what you want to do right now?
I'm curious about it. You know, I've been friends with Sarah Silverman for years now, and I remember her telling me so long ago that one of the things that happens to stand-ups is if they don't allow themselves to grow and change and take on new roles or jobs or just check things out. And I think that applies just in life. It's not, I can't claim that I've always wanted to be the world's biggest director or actor, or, but I had a story to tell, and I like telling stories, and I thought I would try it in a different way than just stand up. And so, and then my special that I'm doing tomorrow, I'm directing that cool. with another director. We're both getting director credits on it. So I'm just curious. I just want to try things. But I'm, I don't know where I'm headed with anything, just well, other than like, oh, that seems fun. Let's try that.
I wanted to talk about a little bit about your origins, I guess, as a comic. What's the first thing you sort of remember that made you want to be a comic? Was there anything?
Well, I mean, I used to watch and listen to stand-up specials and on HBO, and listen to comedy records, and my mother was very, very funny, and I didn't ever think it was an option for me, and I don't know, it was kind of just that off in the distance fantasy of like, yeah, that'd be fun. And but I more consider myself a fan of it, I think. And then, because I didn't think it was an option. And then I remember when I was in seventh grade, I was playing with a friend of mine on the street, which is very safe. And she said, my mom thinks you should be a stand-up comedian. And I remember just feeling so exhilarated. Because even though people appreciated my sense of humor growing up, I always felt like there was kind of a negative to it at times, because I always got in trouble, or I was mischievous, or class clown. And it was the first time it sounded like I could maybe do something with being this little weirdo in the classroom. And then, there's so many different elements of it. And Billy Joel's song, My Life, where he says, friend, I can't remember the line, but the friend like leaves his life and heads out to the West Coast to do stand-up in LA. That exhilarated me too. I was like, to this day, when I hear that song, I'm just like, oh man, that is the dream. And then I'm like, oh right, I'm doing that. But I mean, yeah, I don't know when I really had that moment. I just kind of had different times where it surfaced for me. And then I think in my 20s was when I finally thought, oh, well, I'll try this.
What's the first joke that you told that you were really proud of?
Well, I think I was 7. It was... what consists of a naval army?
What?
Belly buttons.
I had to take a minute there, sorry.
Look, it was years ago, and I apologize. But as far as after I was a professional comedian?
No, not necessarily.
No?
I enjoyed that joke. But sure, after that, too.
Did you really enjoy that
joke? For a 7-year-old, I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, I thought so, too. I also remember sitting at lunch in the cafeteria in elementary school, and the kid sitting next to me opened their bag of Fritos, and the bag was upside down. It said Fritos upside down, and they opened their bag and they were eating it, and I was like, all your Fritos are upside down. I mean, that concept just cracked me up. And that kid was just like, no, they're not. Like, yeah, they are. Look at the bag. Yeah, they're upside down. So, you know who, I don't even, did you ask me another question as far as, well, because I was going to say one of my biggest, what was the last thing you asked me? What was my best joke?
Yeah, or oh, okay. What's the first joke that you told that you were proud of? But
oh yeah, the Naval Army for sure. But but I have to say one of my biggest influences, and sometimes I forget to include this when I say, oh, you know, Gilda Radner, Paula Poundstone, Joan Rivers, all these people, Richard Pryor, the books, Amelia Bedelia, are y'all familiar with those? I hated school from day one, but when it was circle time and the teacher would get out Amelia Bedelia books, I was just like, guys, shh. You want to talk some irony, guys? This is just dynamite. I mean, I feel like that really formed my sensibility. And shake your head at me all you want, man. When her boss would leave for the day and leave a list of things for her to do, and and she'd mark them off, and one of them was draw the drapes. You guys, she set up an easel and drew them. I was sitting front row on my knees, just like. I know you didn't ask about like my influences.
No, I'm glad that Amelia Bedelia is.
Oh my gosh!
Primary.
Raise your hand if you don't know Amelia Bedelia.
Oh, what?
Don't feel shame. Don't. Go to your library and rent, or you know, Amazon or whatever, you know, buy it. I have a friend of mine got me a catalog of Amelia Bedelia books as an adult.
So I wanted to play a clip of your
first birthday party.
Yes. you're at Conan, and it's just a short clip of a bit that I thought was funny that I'm sure you all are familiar with, but would be fun to talk about.
By the way, I'm not sure you're all familiar with that. I appreciate your comment.
They're stans. I believe that they know it. are you surprised by what people find funny?
Well, I guess I'm surprised by what I find funny. And then it's a double surprise when they're like, oh, that's funny. Because that is really, that's another thing that really happened where I was performing in Seattle and I did just slightly, I mean, just maybe like that, like I was just standing doing my set and just kind of moved the stool out of whatever and it made this noise that the whole, like 300 people burst into hysterics. And here my brain just went back to like, I have been up here for a half hour working so hard, delivering material. I have just, and that is the biggest reaction I've gotten. So I just was like, yeah, I'm just gonna push this around. And it was kind of like, I thought it was funny, but I was also toying with them in like a irritated way of, oh, you don't like this stuff, but you like, okay. And then I just drove it into the ground. They stopped laughing. And then I just kept going. They started laughing. And like I said, it went on and on. And one time I did it in St. Paul And I ran the stool off the stage, through the venue, out the door, down the sidewalk. The whole venue walked out of the club with me. I crossed the street with the stool. And I remember these two cars just waiting for me to get the stool across and just seeing all these people on the sidewalk outside the venue. And so curious what those drivers thought was happening, you know, other than obviously mental illness was happening. But everybody was just like, yeah! Yeah! So yeah, it surprises me, but I also I'm surprised as I don't know what I was saying.
Are those moments planned? Because there are other moments in your sets where.
In Seattle, the first time that happened, not planned. St. Paul, I mean, I started doing that for a while, the stool bit, pretty regularly on the road. And then when I did Conan, people were like, push the stool! And I would always think, like, God, if people didn't see that Conan, that just is insane. And then I do, and then it's even more insane to people that don't know what's happening. But in St. Paul, I planned on doing it because it was part of my show, but I didn't plan on going out of the club and down the sidewalk and across the crosswalk. But it was one of those things where once it got going, I was like, what if I just pushed this out of here? Just took off. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, worst case scenario, I owe the club like $30 for a stool.
Well, there's something about taking a joke past its like logical conclusion in some way that I think is brilliant. That
oh,
you
okay.
Do.
I thought you were reprimanding me.
No.
There's something about that that doesn't sit with us here at Vulture. That's why we brought you in.
Because there's in Knock Knock It's Signataro, where you're doing a set in someone's house, you make a clown noise, and then.
Can you do it?
I tried.
Let's hear it. Let's hear your best attempt.
She made me do that.
And we're not moving on. Key gonk. Try it one more time. Okay, I'm going to do it once,
okay.
And then I need you to do
okay.
It after that.
All right.
Okay. Father! Yingonk!
I was doing my version of a clown.
It was horrible.
Okay.
Father! That's pretty good.
Well, you make that noise.
Yes.
And then it just keeps going
mm-hmm.
during the set,
mm-hmm.
and then it also sort of recurs
mm-hmm.
throughout the film.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of like how it sort of pushes the audience
mm-hmm.
about what you think. They, like, at what point does it become absurd? 'Cause
the first time. The very first time.
Right. But the fact that you're listening to it for, like, 20 minutes,
mm-hmm.
then...
Yeah, I mean,
then
in,
the joke is that we're listening to it
yeah,
for 20 minutes.
In Knock Knock, I think I did it for probably realistically 5 to 7 minutes. But there was a show... in San Francisco, where right after I had recovered emotionally and physically from all this stuff I had gone through, I was getting all these offers for these high-profile gigs and more money and all that kind of stuff. And so I took gigs sometimes that I wasn't ready to do, and I didn't have new material yet. And I showed up to this gig in San Francisco, and I was really realizing while I was on stage that I did not have the material to be there. And so I did the clown horn for a half an hour. And the audience would not let me stop. It was one of those things where I was like, I wish I had started earlier. You know, it's the same feeling with the stool on Conan. I wish, because that starts with a few jokes and then it goes into the stool. Whereas when I taped it, I left going, God, I wish I had done it the whole 6 or 7 minutes that I was on Conan, you know? And when does it become absurd? I really do think immediately.
No, I agree. But I think the absurdity changes.
Yeah, there's different levels of it. And this isn't about absurdity, but this is just a side note that I really am proud of. On Conan, when I was pushing the stool, when I couldn't quite get the traction on the, I mean, I'm being taped on television, there's the panic because you're like, oh my God, I'm doing this bit and it's not even making a noise, the stool. And that's when I like went up onto the, up where Conan was, because I saw this platform, like this plexiglass that had lighting underneath it, and I was like, oh, I bet that'll make a good noise. And I went up there and I started, and it was making just the sweet squeak noise. And then they had to remove that plexiglass and buff out all the damage I had done to it. Like I had completely damaged his stage. And then Conan told me the next time I went on there that for weeks, if not months after that, the sound guy would torture Conan with just the clip of the of the squeaking through rehearsal. When Conan would be like, that is enough, please, no more.
So my understanding is that you moved to LA in the mid-90s. Mm-hmm. And that's when you sort of started doing comedies at open mics, or uh-huh. started doing stand-up at open mics.
Comedies.
And people talk a lot about the alt comedy scene, and I was just sort of, and Knock Knock It's Tignataro, where you go to people's houses, is mm-hmm. to me the literal, like the ultimate alt comedy scene, right? Because you're taking it off the club route completely, and you're just going to people's houses.
Yeah. I guess I am associated with the alt scene, but it's really interesting to me because I guess alternative comedy started out in exactly that way of an alternative room.
Right.
Yeah, something that is not a traditional comedy club. And comedians that felt like they had something different to say or do and didn't feel like the confines of a traditional club would really allow for that. And I wasn't a part of that original movement, but I enjoyed those rooms when I did them. But I also, if you look at my history of doing stand-up, I've always done comedy clubs, colleges, theaters. There was this preacher, this born-again preacher that wanted, he was a fan of my stand-up, and he asked me to do a tour through churches to help raise money to build homes and schools in Africa. And I was like, yeah, I'll do that. And he didn't ask me to change anything about my style or censor, not that I'm hard to take, but you know, I'm not a religious person. I am a homosexual, and he didn't Woo. Ask me to, it's nice to have one woo. But I get, my point is I just love performing, whether it's a born-again church. It was really a fun thing to go up on stage in front of people that were not familiar with me, had completely different views than I did, and to tell them that I didn't believe in what they believed, but not in an offensive in their way kind of thing, just like, oh my gosh, we're very different. You know, and standing there in their churches, that was exhilarating for me. And so to me, it's all just an opportunity to perform. And I don't, a lot of alternative comedians, I guess, are opposed to stand-up clubs. And sometimes they can be not so fun, but then sometimes they're the best, you know? And I really think I just, whether it's a living room, a born-again church, or a theater, or I just really enjoy kind of taking on the room and the moment. And, whether it's gay or alternative or cancer or all that stuff, a female comedian, none of those interest me, mm-hmm. How people perceive me, what they label me as or think of me. I really don't feel attached to any of those things.
Right, yeah. And I think that's reflective in your comedy too. Uh-huh. Like it sort of, there's something very funny and humane about it in mm-hmm. some way, in that it never, there's no mean-spiritedness to it, uh-huh. which is striking to me sometimes, because I think a lot of comics will do a lot of jokes about, well, men are like this, or women are like this, or white people are like this, or, whatever. And your comedy doesn't do that. It sort of moves. It's not interested in it uh-huh. at all?
It's not. It's like people have asked why I avoid certain topics and why don't you, I don't cuss on stage. And it's just there's certain things that appeal to me. I'm not avoiding topics or whatever comes up for me genuinely to say on stage, I want to do that. I don't know what I'm saying. But but yeah, one of the things that I was really nice about doing Knock Knock, It's Tig Notaro, was that I got a lot of feedback that people enjoyed, that it could have easily been me and John Doerr going through Middle America and just like totally ripping people apart.
Right.
And that it doesn't interest me.
Right.
Stephanie called it like an ode to comedy and people in America, and I really thought that was kind of a nice way to describe it, because I don't want to go through and like, tear right. people apart. Think that, I don't know. I thought also John Doerr is, I'm sure plenty of you are familiar with John Doerr. He's just really fantastic, and he's just he has that openness and easiness that I didn't feel like I'd be going in with him, with somebody that was like ready to, laugh at other people,
right.
So
you've done so many different venues. What was the toughest room you've ever had to do?
Well, I was in Ireland, and I went on stage at, 1 in the morning in a bar in Ireland with a very low energy, and out of the gate, they were just so horrible. They were just like, you are the worst, you're not funny, you're ugly, get off the stage. And I still had like 40 minutes to go. That was out of the gate. And that was really rough. But it also made me, it was that learning curve of realizing that no one thing is gonna make or break you, because I thought that everybody back in the States heard about it and was talking about it, and nobody even remembered that I was alive, And so it also made me show up to the States, getting back on stage, feeling totally invincible, because you can't get worse than that. So anything, like maybe I tell a new joke or story and it doesn't go well, and people are like, thank you, but it's not being yelled at for your entire
set. How did you get through that set?
I honestly almost started crying when I got off stage. I wanted to, oh, you think that's funny? it kind of was. I was just kind of battling. I was really trying to defend myself, and I don't know, honestly. I don't know how I got through, but I remember when I got off stage, there was another comedian coming on after me, and I wanted more than anything to run out of the venue. Well, what was funny was the town was so small that when I first got to town, there was like 10 comedians at the festival, and so everybody's face was on a poster everywhere you went. And so when I took my dry cleaning in, they're like, "Tig, oh," you know, like, and I didn't even have to tell them my name. My face was everywhere. And there's kind of this, you know, yeah, that's me. And then when I bombed like that, it was, oh yeah, hi, I'm Tig. You heard what happened at the pub. So when I got off stage, I wanted to bolt out of that room so bad, but instead I got off stage and I sat down at a chair and watched the next comedian acting like I wasn't about to cry the whole time. It's not a funny ending, but it's just I didn't hear a thing the other comedian said. I didn't want those people to think that they destroyed me, and I don't know that that was the right thing to do, but I just could not be run out of there. So I just was like, I'm sure I seemed insane. Like, why would you not run out of there? But I was like, okay. And then I, when she finished, I got out of there as fast as I could. That was the worst gig possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of going through terrible things.
Yeah.
like me making clown noises. I was thinking we could listen to a clip from Live, which is your set that you did at Largo.
Oh, okay. And
I was telling more for them.
Oh, okay.
There's no video, obviously, so we're just gonna have to sit quietly and listen to it. I hope that's okay.
Just imagine me having cancer. It is so, I mean, obviously that's an awkward set, but it is so hard to listen to me do stand-up. It's just like I was saying. Yeah, I'm like, oh my God. Can't
we can play Clown Service again.
Yeah, I was gonna say that, I'm fine with that, but listening to my stand-up, can't deal with it.
What about that?
I don't know what that is. I mean, it's not one of those things where I'm like, oh, I hate myself, and I don't know what it is. It's just that I don't know. Just not interested in that. Yeah.
So to give people a little bit of context, you in that moment you or there was a 4-month run where you got pneumonia, you got C. diff, which is a bacterial infection, I think, in your intestines.
Yeah. Right?
And then, your mother died in a freak accident. Your partner broke up with you, and then you were diagnosed with stage 2 breast cancer.
Now, this is a weird side note that I always have to correct. I wasn't broken up with. Okay. I went through a breakup. Because people always are like, ah, what a horrible person that left you. And it's like, that isn't what happened. We broke up during that time. So I always want to be clear that nobody left me.
Okay.
When I had cancer.
Okay.
It's
an important clarification.
Yeah.
Do people ask about your health a lot when they come up to see you?
Yeah.
Does it bother you?
No. I mean, any sort of interaction, especially when I don't really know somebody, it's nice when it's kind of a little more on the brief side than, you know, unless we're really having a true connection somewhere. Mm. But a lot of times I'll be on the sidewalk or at an event or something, at a show, and people are like, how are you feeling? I'm like, good, you know? A little bit of pain in my stomach here or there, but I'm good, thanks, you know?
How are you feeling?
Huh?
How are you feeling?
A little pain in my stomach here. No, but it's nice, you know, when people are just kind of... I was in New York, actually, a year or so ago, and this woman came up to me, and she's like, hey, I know you have kind of specific eating issues and needs, and I just want to let you know that if you're wanting food right across the street, I think it would have a great menu for you. I was like, oh, that's so nice, you know? But yeah, that kind of thing, it's like, I really appreciate that.
New Yorkers are nice people.
Huh?
New Yorkers are nice people. I think.
Yeah, well, I've really found that in general, people are very kind and helpful, and so many people need help themselves, and that's one of the amazing things that my album and my story did was, you know, it touched people, and then in turn, they've told me their stories through email and when I see them at shows and things, and then that touches me, and it's kind of this cycle of inspiring each other and touching each other, and it's really, I feel very lucky to have experienced that. Mm.
I listened in previous interviews where you said that you couldn't imagine doing older material that night.
Mm-hmm.
Does it feel like your comedy has changed fundamentally since then? And if so, like how?
I think that my comedy has changed so much my whole career. Mm. And I remember, when I first started doing stand-up, I did a lot more one-liners and shorter bits, and then I wanted to do jokes or stories that were a little longer, and so I allowed myself to do that. And then I wanted to do physical things, I allowed myself to do that. And then I wanted to tell a story that was like 15 minutes long, and I allowed myself to do that. And I kept thinking about if somebody, one of my peers came up and said, hey, you know, I'm thinking about doing this thing. I don't normally play music, but I kind of want to do that. I would never be like, oh, if you don't normally do that, then don't get started now. Don't change ever. Don't grow, don't change, just stick to your thing. And so I think it's important in your work, in your life, to that cliche saying of take your own advice, you know? Mm. And it's really been helpful for me. And so I wasn't typically that cathartic on stage, but it was what I wanted to do right then. And so I think it went along with how I've allowed myself to do exactly what I want to do. And after that album came out, people were like, is that how you're going to be? And people were comparing me to, like, you know, just like, you know, truth-telling, dark kind of comedy comedians. And I was like, I don't know. I mean, I really love silliness. Like the core of me, I just love silliness, and which I think can be in any aspect of comedy or anything you do.
Right.
But there's no way I was just going to become this really like intense, serious comedian that was like, you know, getting political and you know, all that. And you can be silly with politics, but I don't know.
Even during that set, though, there's a lot of silliness. Mm-hmm. Like there, like the funny cancer greeting cards,
mm-hmm.
and also the survey that they sent your mom,
mm-hmm.
after she passed. There are these, I think, humorous observations of like how life is sort of inherently ridiculous in some sense.
Yeah. I didn't find it funny when I got back from my mother's funeral and got the survey for her. I was just gutted, and I was so mad. And then it just kept running through my brain, just like, how does that happen that my mother could die in this hospital and then they send her the survey of how her stay went? I wanted to kill somebody. And then as it got closer to the time to do a performance, I just, I was like, that's kind of funny. That's kind of funny. Yeah.
Louis C.K. said that it was one of the greatest sets that he had seen. And I was curious what other comics said to you or if they talked to you about that set afterwards.
You know, if there are other comedians that don't like me or don't like that set, or just like, what is the big deal? Come on. Nobody's treated me that way or really said that to me. People have always been kind of very supportive, and I'm sure there's some annoyance to some comedians, like, oh, you do that, and okay, you know. But for the most part, everybody has just been very kind, and but I assume that there are some people that maybe aren't impressed by me, but they keep it to themselves. Mm. But yeah, you know, I think, I don't know. I think there was like a lot of press about Louis and Bill Burr and Ed Helms and stuff tweeting and being very vocal about it and other people, but I'm not quite sure what people think. Or there have definitely been people that have reached out and written to me. And
have you been able to take stock of that set and how it sort of changed your career fundamentally in some sense?
Yeah, and it's an interesting thing, because I was just talking to Stephanie about this, how there's sometimes when a performer kind of does something or reaches a certain place, people and press kind of just push them forward like they're untouchable and they're perfect and they're, you know, everything they do is really great. And, you know, sometimes, and not to say that I think everybody thinks I'm great, but sometimes I can feel like this wave that I'm getting pushed on of like, I'm, you know, like I want some honest criticism, you know? Like, if something isn't great, or I remember there's a documentary being made about, or that was made about my life that came out at Sundance, and people were really great about it. And then one person was like, you could put it on in the background while you fold your clothes, you know? And I was like, okay, all right, you know, that's fair, that's honest, it's not for everyone. But I think, not that I want to be torn down, but I also don't want to just get on a wave and just be like, everything I do is great. I remember when after my album Live came out, I had no material. I was doing a clown horn. And I went to a couple of big prestigious comedy festivals, and I really had no material. And I got rave reviews. And I was just like, oh, this feels horrible, you know? Because, not that I want to be torn down, but I want an honest examination. Not that I also want to live my life by listening to reviews or, but you know what I'm saying. I just don't ever want to be on some crazy wave of like, you know, she just, this is great.
The golden,
you
know, ox.
What's that?
Like a golden ox.
Yeah, it's just, it doesn't interest me really. But my life and my career has definitely changed. And the more it changes, the more, you know, people are always like, what is your next project? What's the big project? And I always say, like, honestly, I want to be married. I want to have children. And I want a bird watch in our backyard. Like, that is my biggest goal right now, my biggest, I'm sure my representation wouldn't be thrilled to hear it, but you know, they're like trying to square away deals, and I'm like, listen, we got new birdhouses. But I really, we have so many birdhouses and bird feeders like hanging in our every window of our house. And I'm like always angling for the perfect angle for to be able to see birds wherever I am. You know? Like, I want to have a great, fun, interesting career, but I don't, I'm not interested in that whole thing. Hmm. You know what I mean? I don't know if I'm being clear about that. Birds. That's what it all comes down to, birds. Stephanie's laughing because I'll be on the road and I'm like, so how are the bird feeders? Are they, where are they on the, and she'll send me pictures of the, you know, different, you know. My manager calls, I'm like, can I call you back? Hold on, I think that's Stephanie calling about the bird feeder that just arrived. Hold on. Hey. Oh, it fell. Oh, okay. We did. We had a very beautiful bird feeder fall. Yeah.
I can't wait for you.
And it just like, it shattered. It was so devastating.
I can't wait.
Look, my apologies.
I can't wait for you to have kids because I think you're the material that may eventually come out of that would be.
Oh my gosh, people were people talk about how you write your best material when you're miserable, and which it's true. It's like you're supposed to be a tortured artist and whatever. And I couldn't be happier. And this material that I've written in the past year and a half or so, I know a lot of people say that, it's like, oh, it's my best stuff, but I really feel like it's the best I've ever done. And I don't want to come from a place of misery. I think you can find inspiration outside of utter darkness. I don't want to be drawn to that for, you know, the digging from the well at all. And yeah, so, but as far as kids, yeah, I would love to be the person, I want to turn into the person you dread. Like that when you, I'm sorry, but I do. When you come to my show next, I'm going to be ranting about how happy I am and about Itsy and Bitsy. Those are our kids' names. And the bird watching. I'm sorry. I'm just giving you a heads up. It's just, it's that's what I have in store.
Great.
Thank you. I feel like that was not authentic. You're not.
What is your new material like?
It's very dark. some of the darkest yet. It's... I really tell you how it is. I explore politics. No, I talk a lot about being a comedian and traveling and my experiences. I touch on losing my mother and my new relationship. I mean, Stephanie and I have been together a couple years now. So it's not that new, but it's new. And my diagnosis, post-diagnosis, and traveling and just silly stuff, music, my love for music. Yeah, but it's not out of, it's not really from a dark place, but I guess there's dark moments.
Well, we have about 15 minutes left, and I thought we could open it up to the audience for questions. I see a person right over there.
Stephanie, do you want to come join us?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, come,
Stephanie
come join
to
us.
Come up.
Hello.
So you can ask about the relationship?
Yeah, about our birdhouses.
Hello.
She doesn't work here, by the way.
When you were first starting off and doing open mics, and I'm guessing you were probably like doing other things at the same time to like be able to buy groceries and shit like that, or sorry.
That's okay.
What? How did you? How did you continue doing open mics before comedy was like your main thing and you weren't like making money off of it? Like why did you keep going to open mics, like, especially like if you were having a period where like you couldn't write a lot of material? Like how did you, this is a cliche question, but why did you keep going, I guess?
First of all, very concise question. No. You know what, I went and I got a day job. I worked for the director, Sam Raimi, and he actually invested in Clown Service and another short film that I made. And I just wanted to go get a day job where I got insurance and, you know, money for groceries and shit. And, sorry. And then that way I got off work every day at 7 o'clock, and then I would go immediately to the open mics and sign up, and I couldn't wait every night. I remember I was performing in Seattle once, and the owner of the club came up and was like, hey, so there's a group of female comedians here. I told them they all need to come watch you, and they, I told them to ask you questions in between the early and late show. And I was like, this sounds horrifying. Just because I'm sometimes not great in that kind of situation. But they would ask me, they were asking me, how many days a week should I be on stage? And I'm like, if you're asking that, then you're not passionate about it. It can't be Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, I did my comedies. And then, you know, and then they were like, oh, and also, you know, we have this room where it's just girls are allowed and it's a very safe room. And I'm like, that's bad. You know, comedy, you shouldn't feel safe. Not that you want to be like in the situation I was in Ireland or having people physically attack you. But when you're on the edge is the most exciting, and you really get to grow. And but anyway, I loved the open mic days. I felt very much happy and willing to pay my dues. And but I had a day job, and not sure if I answered your question.
Next question.
Have you done something silly or completely destroying the tombstone of John Bonham?
In Knock Knock, it's Tig Notaro. John Doerr and I we're driving along and we saw this place that sold tombstones and firecrackers, fireworks, and we were just like, well, we have to go there. And we pulled over, and it's a really fun scene because we explained to the owner that I've had some health issues and we're just trying to think ahead. And John is wanting to treat me to my tombstone. And the guy does not know what to make of us. And
he's just nodding.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, cool. What do you want?
But he's also just like, we bought the tombstone.
The base on the headstone, right?
Yes, but here's the thing. We let him keep it. We paid him for his time, and then we just left the tombstone there. I don't know if I'm supposed to tell those secrets. So we didn't do anything too silly with it. It would have been very expensive for us to like ship that back to Los Angeles to be like, then I find out I really need it. Guys, relax. All right, so that's it.
So I think about this every time I listen to the Taylor Dane story on your album. I keep wondering whether you keep seeing her. Have you run into her like since then, or
Well, did you see the video of the Taylor Dane bit for This American Life?
No.
Go online.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. Watch that, and then I'll see you at the next Vulture.
Cool, okay, cool. Sounds good, sounds good.
I tried to clip that for the record, but it was too long.
Yeah.
And the producers were like, you can't just watch a clip for 15 minutes. And I was like, but it's really good.
Yeah, but it's specifically This American Life, and it's a video. Check it out.
So recently Louis C.K. got a lot of backlash on social media for his SNL monologue, and in the past Sarah Silverman and Dana Tosh and other comedians have gotten in trouble for jokes they do in their set. Do you feel that, are there any topics that even if you can make them funny, comedians should avoid in this day and age?
You never know an angle that somebody's gonna come from, and it can surprise you that the humor you can find it in. I mean, I'm not an edgy comedian. I don't really touch on things like that, but I think that so many comedians can do it really well. And I think the talk show host, James Corden, I think in Louis's defense, made some comment about how it's okay if you're offended. You know, like, okay, you're offended. That's okay. Isn't it kind of okay to just be offended? Like, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I feel okay with people saying what they want. And if it's not for you, then walk away, turn it off, don't support them, rise up.
Can we go?
That you've enjoyed working with the most? I don't know if that's John Dorff, that's somebody else, but is there somebody that you really like enjoyed working with in particular?
Oh, well, gosh, I'm doing my HBO special tomorrow night, and I'm having New York's very own Aparna Nancula open, and she is mind-blowing. She's somebody where every time I see her, every year, I can't believe how much funnier and more solid and amazing she is. And she doesn't like linger around and like, she's not, you know, kissing anyone's ass. She comes in really nice, you know, destroys the room, heads out. And you're just like, don't you want tips from me? Don't you want to get a picture with me or something? Or where's Aparna? She left like immediately after her set. I love it. She just needs nothing. Just that's it, you know? And I think she's so fresh, and she's just a kind, good person, and funnier and weirder than most out there. Look her up if you don't know her, Aparna. And yeah, John Doerr is amazing. I mean, he's so ridiculous, I can't deal with it. And if you haven't seen Knock Knock, It's Tig Notaro, it's on Showtime, I think on demand, so. And watch how ridiculous that man is.
Do we have other questions?
I was just gonna ask Stephanie what your favorite bit of Tig's is, or joke.
I wanted to ask that too.
We will be here a while.
Can I, because I, what's in your current show? Is that?
I didn't ask the question, Stephanie.
I don't know. Like her, there she has. Well, I mean, I think Tig's so funny every day, but in her new hour special, she has a run about pigs that is really, really funny, and it's all puns. And and like, it's so ridiculous and so silly, and I've seen it probably maybe 100 times, and it always makes me laugh.
It's and my favorite part, too. It's just like you do comedy for a while, and you're like supposed to become sophisticated, but then it's like, I don't know if that's true for me. I just do a string of pig puns, and then I'm out.
Or that's what's so funny about it, is that you are so sort of, you're at this place in your career, and then in the middle of an hour is this really weird, silly, like, if you had never done comedy before and that was your only bit, it would be like, this person is crazy. But like in the midst of this other stuff, it's the best. It's so funny.
Thank you.
No, thank you.
Stephanie, can you eat 3 pizzas in one sitting?
Yes.
Are you going to prove that?
Yeah, I am. We're going to do that, I think, in a month.
I don't know.
Definitely. On Professor Blastoff, Tig has shared that I thought I could eat 3 large pizzas, which I do think I can do. And so we're going to do an episode of Professor Blastoff where I eat 3 large pizzas with a few other people who also think they can eat 3 large pizzas.
No, everybody, all these other people that are grown large men, say they could never possibly eat 3 large pizzas.
Rick and Molly Ringwald's husband thinks he can do 3.
For people that haven't heard the show, Molly Ringwald's husband said he could.
He did. He thinks he can, right?
No, I know, but that sounds ridiculous to people. I mean, yes, of course, but...
It's really one of these things where, like, I truly believe I can do this, and the entire world is telling me otherwise. Or it's like, this huge guy was like, you can't do that. I couldn't do that. And I'm, like, looking at him going, like, I truly think I can. So...
Wait, hold on 1 second. This is video of Stephanie talking about this at our house while she's looking at a pizza larger than the sun.
Looking at this, I would like to try smaller ones, but I do think that I can eat 3 of these. Okay.
What?
I do.
I have like 300 videos of her. Anytime she's talks about pizza, there's a pizza nearby, she always says something about it, and I always pull my phone out, and I'm like, hold on a second. And so it's just, I have a full-length feature of Stephanie talking about eating pizza. So
you could start a Tumblr.
And the other day, donuts came up, and she was like, how many donuts do you think you could eat? I was like, I don't know, 2 or 3, and she was like total?
Well, I don't mean it like, if in a way where you're like, if you were in a competition or you were being paid, how many could you eat? And you said 2.
I said like 2 apple fritters. They're like that big. And she was like, oh, 3 dozen, no problem. I can't believe the competition hasn't gone to like competitive bird watching at our house.
Oh my God.
Is there a standard to the pizza? Like, would it be deep dish? Would it be thin crust?
Thin crust, thin crust.
Anytime Stephanie eating pizzas comes up, that's all anyone wants to talk about. Nobody cares about comedy influence, inspiration, who you know, what's your next project? It is like, are we talking just cheese pizzas? I mean, people become obsessed with it. Like, it could become its own podcast of people analyzing and discussing pizzas that Stephanie could or couldn't eat. Are we talking thick crust?
I am going to do it. Huh? I'm going to do an episode.
All right. I don't want you to die.
Thank you.
We have Itsy and Bitsy coming.
I think we have time for one last question, if someone wants to throw it in. No pressure.
Hi.
Hi.
On the podcast, you guys have some really interesting guests, and every episode I've listened to, like, kind of changed my perspective on certain topics. Do you have a personal favorite guest that you've had that really changed, like, how you saw, you know, something?
Thought
of something, like, whatever topic was on.
Gosh.
I'm sorry.
No. No, that's, we've done so many episodes, and, is that cool? I thought you were going to ask something really easy, like, who is your favorite guest and or favorite episode or whatever, but I don't know. What about you? Like, who did you really...
Oh, I really like the Bigger Parts episode.
No. No. Guys, hear him out. Hear him out. Hold on. Let's hear him.
This is terrible. And I said, this is still terrible. But it's more the pathos of being terrible.
Uh huh. But what was your perspective? And then what did you walk away going, like, uh huh. Oh yeah, he was interesting, like.
How did he think that of himself? I don't know. It was weird that he could also influence other people to think like that. I thought that was really.
But do you really think he is? I mean, it.
No, I want to see him in action.
People follow people like that.
Huh? I don't believe, I mean, this guy came on to our show and people were so upset by this man, like in waves where it was reaching us from every area, word of mouth and Twitter and email and comments and just never ending, offended everybody. And for me, when I was in the studio with him, I was just like, what an odd specimen. Of a human, like I couldn't quite get my bearings and like how to approach him or what to do really. And he was interesting, but he didn't really interest me, you know, where I wasn't like, you know, where people that don't like me or they're not interested or they don't think I'm funny or something, they interest me. He just, there was something, you just couldn't, yet you couldn't connect, I couldn't connect with him, so I didn't really leave with a different perspective on him or anything, but I mainly just, again, it was, this is an odd specimen of a human. And I don't mean to always go back to Stephanie, but I found it fascinating, Stephanie's upbringing with religious science, which is the basic idea is to envision it, or...
Imagine the possibility, create the reality.
Yeah, but there's a certain positivity in her personality and her mindset and her openness and her way that I think that changed me because I could never put my finger on what I was noticing was so different and allowing me to love somebody the way that I love her, and I think that it is that clarity and the comfortable, oddly confident comes out in pizza eating contests. But no, just the comfort and openness, and that was something I was unfamiliar with, and that also obviously very immediately touched my life. That sent me in a new direction. Yeah.
Okay.
Seven more questions.
I just want to say thank you to Tig Notaro and Stephanie Allen for joining.
Thank you, and thanks. thank all of you for coming out and watching this this film and being here. I know you have lives, and you know Jerry Seinfeld was at the same time I was, so this is probably Jerry spill off. But what if my segment was called Jerry Spill Off with Tig Notaro? I would take it again. I want honest criticism. I just want you to be honest. But really, thank you for coming. I really appreciate it. So,
thank you.
See ya. Thank you. See ya.